safety from Steve Bauer. So Ronan Pensec, as all the French would like, was now leading the Tour de France.
But on the major leaders in the Tour, Delgado and LeMond, you haven't lost a great deal.
Well, you know, they still have to make up a lot of time, and, you know, I'm still in the bike races. You know, I lost the yellow jersey today, but there's no means, you know, completely out of the race, and I'm still going to push myself, and I'm still in the race. So, you know, tomorrow's another day.
You lost the yellow jersey today, but will we see you in it again before we get back into the mountains?
Never know. Never know.
And how do you feel about losing the yellow jersey? You've lost it before.
Well, you know, I think instead of losing it, I have to think about, you know, the 10 days that I kept it. And that's a great souvenir for my career. And, you know, if I can get it back, I'll get it back. If not, then I'll do my best race.
Bauer is now down to third place overall behind Ronan Pensec and Claudio Chiappucci. Going into stage 11. It's the toughest stage with 16,000 feet of climbing over the Col de la Madeleine and the Glandon passes, leading to Alpe d'Huez. It's 182 and a half kilometres. With long, steep gradients ahead, mechanics have fitted especially low gears. Climbing is the speciality of race leader Pensec, who tells reporters, it's great to be in the yellow jersey, especially for the climbs to Alpe d'Huez. There are many anxious faces among the 180 riders, and 9 of them will have quit the race by the day's end. Approaching the Madeleine Pass, nervous riders touch wheels and Colombian William Palacio falls down, with the fifth place, Raul Alcala. The Madeleine is 25 kilometres long, where the brisk pace is set by Johan Brunel of the Lotto team, and in the white, Charlie Motte of the French RMO squad. Alberto Volpi is the other rider on the far right. About 50 riders are still together as the summit finally appears into view. Riding strongly near the front is the rainbow jersey of the world champion Greg LeMond. And also looking comfortable is the man in the red spotted jersey, the leading climber of Claverola. He's followed by Rux and the race leader Pensec. Into the final kilometre of the climb, only 35 riders remain in the front group. Over the 6,400 feet summit, Claverola sprints clear. 7 seconds later, he's followed over the top by the Spanish rider Miguel Indurain, and just behind by Flor Coquillon and the rest of the leading group. After passing Claverola on the Madeleine descent, Indurain starts the Glandon climb 35 seconds ahead of the Frenchman and a minute ahead of the main group. Claverola takes advice from his team director Bernard Vallée, who as a rider once won the King of the Mountains, in fact in the 1982 Tour de France. Behind, the group is led by the Belgians Brunel and Flor Coquillon, the yellow jersey of Ronan Pensec, Claudio Chiappucci, Charlie Motte and Greg LeMond, who's back in the group after falling and dislocating a finger at a feeding station. This is the other American, Andy Hampston, of the 7-Eleven team, and also here too is the Irishman, Sean Kelly. Rider number 41, the Spaniard, Marino Lajereta. Claverola is now 3 minutes in front and has caught Miguel Indurain. While behind, Le Mans Z team keeps the pace steady, led by Norwegian Atle Volsvold, the Frenchman Cornier and Jerome Simon, and Robert Miller. Le Mans has a good team with him this year. Approaching the Glandon summit, Claverola has dropped Indurain, and the new King of the Mountains leader beats out a steady rhythm of climbing. One complete turn of the pedals every second. To an enormous cheer, Tiddy Claverola goes over the top of the climb. He's a local favorite, and he's carved out a lead of 82 seconds. The man who is behind Tiddy Claverola, it's still Miguel Indurain. 3.5 minutes behind the leader, the main group comes up towards the summit of the Glandon, where they're led by a sprinting Chiappucci. Just like yesterday, Claverola is again out in front by himself. On the long downhill, Claverola is pursued by Indurain, the more talented descender of the two. But Indurain has been caught by Lamond, Bugno and Pedro Delgado. While the brave Claverola continues his solo escapade, but he'll soon be caught. The chase is led by Indurain, working for his team leader, Pedro Delgado. This is Delgado. Benefit of having a man on your team in the chase group. Greg LeMond has to defend the interest of his teammate as well, Ronan Pensek, and he follows the breakaway. Indurain keeps up the ferocious pace ahead of the opportunist, Gianni Bugno. His eyes are on a stage win in the finish at Alpe d'Huez. Claverola will soon be caught by this breakaway group. In which the stylish Indurain is doing the work of two men on this windswept road. Bugno follows, and so too does Indurain's teammate, Delgado. Indurain is doing all of the pulling for Delgado, whose turn will come on the final climb. Neither Tour of Italy winner Gianni Bugno, nor the ambitious Eduardo Chozas is helping Indurain, while Greg LeMond still follows as well. And Tiddy Claverola tries to recuperate from his long solo break. 2 minutes behind, Sean Kelly leads the chase with teammate Eric Birking, while the yellow jersey of Pensek simply follows. Then in Bourg-Voisin, with the Alpe d'Huez climb in sight ahead, Indurain finally sits up and drops away, leaving the other five to battle out the stage. Delgado immediately takes charge on the climb, pressurizing Bugno, Chozas, LeMond and Claverola. Two and a half minutes behind, Robert Miller and Claudie Coquillon leads the chase for Pensek, as Birking follows on comfortably behind them all. Claverola cannot keep pace on this steepest part of the 13 kilometers climb, and he too falls back. This leaves just Bugno and LeMond in Delgado's wake. Behind, Indurain is caught and passed by the chase group. It's still being headed by Claude Coquillon, while Chiappucci, Colombian rider Abelardo Rondon and Pensek look quite at ease. Robert Miller rides particularly hard, followed by his teammate Pensek, Coquillon and Andy Hampston. Pensek is defending his yellow jersey with energy and honour, focusing totally on the slim figure ahead of him, of a seemingly tireless Robert Miller. Remarkably, Claverola is catching back to the leaders. Delgado has suddenly tired, while Greg LeMond still follows and Bugno still waits. The Alpe d'Huez climb is seeing yet another epic battle. Eric Birking has ridden away from the chasers. And 3 kilometers from the summit, After a magnificent chase, he catches the four leaders. Behind, Andy Hampson is showing his best climbing form for years as Pensek hangs on at the back. At the front, Delgado is also dropped as Birking increases the pace. Poor Claverola is struggling again. And this leaves only Bugno and Greg LeMond on the wheel of Birking. And as the leaders head into Alpe d'Huez, the Tour is again taking a decisive turn. Thierry Claverola fights back yet again into contention, but he's dropped once more, as another acceleration by Birking can only be followed by Greg LeMond and Gianni Bugno. They all want to win this most prestigious of stages. 1 kilometre from the finish now. The Colombian Fabio Parra is also catching up. Birking still leads and turns to see who's still with him. Parra continues to approach Thierry Claverola. And Pensek still follows Miller and Claude Poquillon. Through the ski village of Alpe d'Huez, this is now a classic battle. The three leaders are preparing their finishing effort and slow down. And Thierry Claverola, again, he sprints up to join them. Parra joins the leaders as well, and five men head into the final corner, where LeMond dives between Bugno and Birking, and almost falls. LeMond manages to correct himself, and he leads out the sprint from Bugno. The others are beaten. At first, LeMond appears to be winning. But as the finish line approaches, Gianni Bugno is just too strong and takes LeMond right on the line. He's the first Italian winner here since 1952. Crowd flock around the world's number one, Greg LeMond. But if you look at world rankings, you'll find that honor really belongs to Gianni Bugno. Bugno may have been the winner, but LeMond always attracts the media attention. They know that the American is now up to third place overall, and is starting again to look like a potential winner of this tour. Greg LeMond loses his temper with a reporter, telling him not to touch him. He'll answer questions only after he's cleaned up. Delgado's teammate Rondon leads Andy Hampson and his team leader up the final slope. And the exhausted Delgado loses only 40 seconds to LeMond. It could have been a lot worse. And for Andy Hampson, it was for him a very good day on Alpe d'Huez. And for the veteran Claude Poquillon, while Pensek has exceeded all hopes by extending his overall lead over Claudio Chiappucci. He hasn't finished yet, while teammate Greg LeMond is still 9 minutes behind on overall time. Could Pensek now be the new hero that French cycling has been seeking? Gianni Bugno, too, has proved himself. And LeMond?
Is this the kind of Alpe d'Huez ride you knew you had inside of you?
Well, I wasn't certain of it, but I've been feeling really good. I crashed for the second last climb, and I didn't think I'd be that good on the climbs, but it kind of went into not shock, but it shook me up quite a bit.
Tell me about the last 3 kilometers.
Well, we were starting out on the climb. Pedro Delgado did all the pacing. I mean, I felt really good, and I had to do my work as a teammate. We had the lead, and it was only better that it arrived. But I felt kind of sorry for Pedro because he really rode strong, and we were practically standing still towards the last 5 5 kilometers, plus 3 kilometers. And the main thing is I wanted to win the stage, and I was trying to control everybody, and almost went down the last corner and had too big of a gear and let up the sprint too long and lost the stage. But it's good for our team. I think we should be first and second, and it's good Tour de France.
Were you and Delgado working together in a sense today?
No. You've got team orders. I wasn't allowed to work, but it didn't really make. In the last climb, it made a lot of difference between Pedro lost 40 seconds, and we probably could have gained minutes over everybody else had I worked and Bruno worked. But everybody was wanting to win the stage, and was too afraid to do more work than the other guy.
Earlier in the day, you had a crash.
Yeah, I crashed. Dislocated my middle finger. Had to pull it out.
And that made a difference when you almost slipped in the last turn.
Well, yeah, I went to pull on my brakes and my fingers locked up. It was straight, I couldn't bend it. And that's why I couldn't hit my brakes well enough. So I almost went down just last 300 meters.
And now what are you expecting for the time trials tomorrow?
I don't know. No time trials aren't my specialty. I hope to have a good one, but I don't expect to win. I expect to be close.
You have a superstition about the L'Alpe d'Huez stage.
Well, I said it's not so bad that I lost, because it's always been the tradition that if you win L'Alpe d'Huez, you don't win the Tour de France. So it's maybe a good win. It's like a second, maybe still a possibility of winning. If not, we've won the races as a team.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Well, Le Mans can now focus on tomorrow's vital time trial near Grenoble. The course climbs for 30.